Tonight on Life on the Rock, we have members from the community Cenacolo, and I'll give a reflection on God's peace and much more. Welcome to Life on the Rock. Tonight, our guest is Cenacolo. We have the women from the Cenacolo community in St. Augustine, Florida, up to tell us their story, a little bit about their story. And it's always a beautiful sharing of their recovery and what God has done for them in their lives. But what is Cenacolo?
Well, Cenacolo is a house that is basically a rehabilitation center for any type of addiction of any sort. But one of the things that, as you know, one of the ladies expressed it, it says for desperate youth. But it's a house really grounded in prayer and work and also friendship.
And it's very Catholic. They very have adoration Catholic, yeah. And a great priest presence there. Yeah. Tonight we're also going to show you a video I recently made about God's peace and finding it, how He's prepared a home for us and we're destined to be with Him for all eternity. So we hope you enjoy our show tonight. Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? John chapter 14. You know, Jesus prepares a place for us through his paschal mystery, his suffering, death, and resurrection. He has reconciled us with God. He's given us eternal life that we can share forever with the Heavenly Father in the Father's house. I find that such a comforting thought that Jesus has gone before us, ascended to his Father. He's waiting for us to join him in the Father's house, to enjoy the beatific vision, to have this blessed life with him for all eternity. He's waiting for you. He has a personal love for you. I remember when I was growing up, we would go to visit my grandparents in New Orleans, and it was like an 8-hour drive. And my grandmother was a great cook, and she was very hospitable, had a beautiful home. And I looked forward to that as a child, the excitement of going to that beautiful home and just eating our hearts out, you know, eating as much as we wanted there, and just being with the family. It was a great time. Jesus is waiting for you. He has prepared a place for you. He loves you. He's guiding you to the Father's house by his providence. Our call is to have faith in him, that we are being guided by him. And that's a source of peace, that we can overcome fear with that faith, that trust, that he has a plan for our life. We're destined to be with him for all eternity. That's a providential plan that he has for each one of us. May the Lord give you his peace. Well, welcome, Carrie and Cassidy, to Life on the Rock. Go stretch out there. We don't have much time here, but I wanted to hear your story of coming to Cenacolo, Carrie. Tell us a little bit of a thumbnail of your story.
Okay, well, when I was born, a little bit after I was born, my mom passed away, and my dad was a really bad alcoholic, and I grew up with my grandmother, who was actually Jewish, and then growing up with that, I don't know, it was really, I had a lot of like pain inside, just a lot of sadness, and I never really knew how to deal with it. And then getting older, when I was 7, I moved in with a different family, and they were Catholic, but they weren't really practicing. You know, they went to church for Christmas and Easter, and just kind of in that way of thinking, that kind of lifestyle, mm-hmm. I could never deal with the things that I was like living inside. Mm-hmm. And then as I got older, when I was a sophomore in high school, I started using drugs, and it escalated really quickly. And within a week, I was using drugs every single day. Yeah. And then for about 5 years, like, I went into a really bad heroin addiction, and I was in and out of rehabs, mm-hmm. and I was actually about to go to jail. And instead, my aunt had heard about the community in Medjugorje because she went over and found out about the community and then told me about it. And And at that point, I was at my last straw, and I kind of, you know, I had nothing left. I had nothing left. And so then I came, and I don't know, I never prayed before community, and never did anything like that. And so our lifestyle is based on work, prayer, and friendship.
Yeah.
And the prayer was something that I didn't really want.
Mm-hmm.
But over time, like, I saw the people who had been in the community longer than me, and that was something that they were doing,
mm-hmm.
and that I wasn't doing. And I still wasn't happy, and I still wasn't fulfilled. And so I started praying, and that was really what changed me. That's really what, like, transformed me was God.
Right. And Cassidy, you were telling me your story. It was interesting that you were a straight-A student, and then had a divorce in the family, right? And
well, my mom, I have a different dad. I'm the oldest of seven girls, and my dad adopted me when I was 5 and got married to my mom, and then I had 6 younger sisters.
Mm.
So, yeah, I always felt different in my family, and that was really hard for me, and I didn't really know how to handle that, but I always did really well in school. I went to an all-girls Catholic prep school.
Straight-A student.
Yep, and I did sports, and I was class treasurer, and I did everything well on paper. But then my junior year of high school, I started to, like, not do as well, to be, like, sad. I was doing everything right, but it didn't make me happy, and I, like, lived loneliness in my family, and then started to do worse in school. So I ended up dropping out. And then I went to public school for my senior year, and, like, really quickly after that, I started getting in with the wrong people, and then slowly but surely started to do drugs, and then, like, I didn't end up applying to college, and then everything just kind of crumbled.
Yeah. And when you came to community, what were some of the things that really helped you to grow?
I think the friendship, definitely. We're put with someone who we're with all the time, and you experience, like, real friendship, and through that you grow in trust with this person, and you're, like, able to open up. And then, like Carrie said, the prayer. I think that, like, the prayer is something that we don't have before, and we're always gonna have a lot of the same characteristics, the same things that we, like, struggle with. There's still moments in community where I can feel lonely, but because of the prayer, like, I am able to handle myself differently, because I know that it's not just me, that I have God too.
Right. Now, Carrie, you had a great experience to go to Italy to be with Mother Elvira, the foundress of Cenacolo. Tell us what you learned from that experience.
Well, we stayed with her and the sisters for 3 months. It was a group of us, and I don't know, just being with her, I'm sure, like, if you knew Mother Angelica, like, knowing her, just being in the presence of a saint, like, you can really feel, like, God in them. And I think just something that really touched me about her life is when she said yes to God's will, when she said yes to God, when she gave her whole life, her everything to Him. It was God that really shone through her life, shone through everything that she did. And
she was all in for God.
Oh, yeah.
I met her. It was like everything was
blown.
Yeah.
And she's really, like, I don't know, she's really, like, strong. She's really, like, a woman that moves, that does, that mm-hmm. that does a lot of things, and you know, will hit you at times, but mm-hmm. like, I don't know, for me it was really,
it's kind of the Italian thing.
It was really touching to see someone, like, fully themselves and fully alive. Like, in God, and like, who God wanted her to be, you know?
Yeah. I know you're a musician, a singer, a songwriter. You developed a musical about Mother Elvira, but I want to ask you about the song Stay. I heard you all sing that years ago. Tell us about that song.
Well, actually, that was the first song that I ever wrote in the community, and before, I always liked music, and I always had, like a gift, but I never did anything with it. And then coming to the community, I just discovered my prayer really through the music. And there was a time in my walk when I still felt, like, really hopeless inside, and and just kind of sad, and I still really didn't have that relationship with God yet. And then I started, you know, writing the song, and I just started playing and singing, and it just kind of came out, and it was just my prayer in that moment of like desperation, and I really felt like God like heard me and that he was with me in that moment, and it's kind of how that song came about.
Yeah, that he's with us, his presence is with us. Well, thank you so much for sharing some of your journey with us. We're going to have two other members from Cenacolo out just after this break, so don't go away. Lucian and Emily, welcome to Life on the Rock.
And thank you.
You've been in the community 6 years, and then Emily 5 years. You all are part of the missions of Cenacolo. Tell us about the missions. What do y'all do there?
Well, I entered the house in Villa El Salvador. It's in Peru. And the house consists of kids from 0 to 3 year olds. Mm-hmm. And I live with missionaries and also sisters. And
Cenacolo has sisters. And a men's community and a women's community. So you're working alongside them.
Okay. Yeah. And that house was just something that I was able to just give my life to. And there's like kids that need love. There are abandoned kids from all over the slum areas of Peru. And it just helped me to appreciate life and like give of myself by taking care of them and like being their mother for them, loving them, teaching them how to pray, how to eat, and just constantly, you know, changing diapers and just being by their side. And it's something that filled my heart by giving back to the community for all that it has done for me.
Yeah. And how important is that in recovery, that often we think of a person going to rehab, getting all this treatment, but Cenacolo is like winding them up and sending them out to give. Yeah. It's kind of counterintuitive, isn't it?
It's kind of almost like the one thing that can really, you know, that actually gives life and heals and fills is giving yourself. I think, and that's something that I really experienced with going to the mission. I was there for 2 years, and I got the opportunity to be in the orphanages. We have two houses there, and I was able to stay there for 2 years I was with the babies, the children from 5 to 6 years old, and also the teenagers. So I kind of got to experience the whole. Experience of all ages, and for me it's really beautiful because they come to us, you know, some of them come to us from extremely difficult life situation, extreme poverty, and you see that a lot of them are smiling and they have joy, and for me that it shows that really life is not about how much you have, but really who you are and what you have to give. You know, these kids who have nothing are smiling, and how important it is, you know, to see that joy is not what you have. And it's cool because they come from like difficult situations in which like some of them come, you find them in trash cans and they come to us all dirty, and you just look at them and you just want to love them, and you know, we get them all cleaned up, we take them, like we give them a shower, we change their diapers, and from that moment on that they come to us, we're with them 24/7. So it's a life that's always moving, always moving. It's very fast paced and very like, it takes away a lot of your energy, but the only strength that I found that got me through those things was the prayer, you know, to ask God, like, help me. I'm not a mother, I'm not their mother, but please give me the strength to love them. Give me the strength to give what I can, you know? And I was sleeping at night with, like, it was my bed and then 5 other cribs, you know? Like, and then they would be, like, up during the night and these things, and I'm like, out of energy, but the moments like that, you just have to pray and say, please give me strength. And you know, they'd be up in the morning, like, before
you,
already waiting for you to wake up, and you have to say yes in all those moments. And that's what Mother Elvira teaches us, is to say yes, you know, say yes to life, to serve, to give, even in the moments when it's really hard, you know. And
did y'all have a maternal instinct before you went, or
absolutely
did you discover
not
it? What happened?
I'm not gentle at all. I'm rough. I slam the doors, and when you go there, you become a mother of what it really is, and you learn to love and give of yourself and be more gentle and like be aware of their needs. And it definitely took something out of me. I'm definitely grateful and just kind of know what a mother is like, and it's hard. It's hard sacrificing, but once you love, you do it freely, even though you're tired, you have bags in your eyes, but It just keeps you going forward.
And the prayer life for you, I mean, could you even find time to pray? It was with five kids around you, I mean, how do you, for you, like the strength from the prayer?
Okay, so briefly, like before community, I didn't pray at all. I grew up in a Catholic family, but I didn't understand what prayer is, like how I've learned in community. And it's something that just saved me, being in front of the Blessed Sacrament every single day. My first year, I really didn't feel anything. I'm like, what's the point? I'm just in front of this piece of bread. I don't really know what it is. Mm-hmm. But as I go forward, I've grown into this deep connection with Jesus Christ, and he loves me, and he cares for me. And he's like, okay, whatever you did in your past, just leave it there, and embraced me for how I am. And this is something that I need. Even if I leave community, if I go somewhere else, I need to bring with me everywhere the prayer life and my interaction with Jesus and his mercy. And sometimes, like you said, the missions, it's hard, but I try to always find my way there, even just for like 30 minutes or an hour, to get that strength to keep going forward, right?
Emily, is there a particular story from your work in the missions that just really sticks with you? Like a young person you saw grow, change, or?
Okay, so there's this little boy named Jose Fernando, and he's 6 years old, and I was with him. I was his auntie, we call it. I was like the one in charge of him, and he was very special to me because he was always the oldest one of the group, and he was just like always helping me, and like when the kids would fight, he would separate them and these things, and he was a very good boy. And basically, like when you turn 6 years old in the mission, you have to go with the uncle missionaries. So he had to be separated from me. And we had grown in a very strong, you know, relationship. And when he went over to the uncles, he kind of started like rejecting me. You know, like kind of started pretending like he didn't know me because he was the youngest in the group and kind of like too cool, you know, and he wanted to make his place in the room, okay? So this kind of like hurt me inside because I was always saying hi to him. I was like, hi, Jose Fernando, how are you? How was school today? You know, and he would just be like, like not know who the T.O. was anymore. When I spent every single day with this child, you know, like doing his homework, putting him in bed, waking him up, like, you know, and then like to have that detachment, it was so hard for me. And I'm like, what am I doing wrong? Did I do something wrong as the auntie? What can I do? You know, and then a couple weeks passed, and maybe a month, and then his uncle came up to me and said, I have to tell you something. And I said, what? And he's like, it's about Jose Fernando. And this was after the time that he's been like just completely ignoring me. And he tells me, he said, okay, it's Mother's Day. In Peru, they call it Dia de la Mama. And he said, he has to pick a mom for his school and take a picture with her and do a project with her and stuff. And he's like, Jose Fernando, he chose you. And I just start crying. And I'm like, he did. Okay, so he really doesn't like dislike me. It's not like I did anything wrong. It's not that. Like, I persevered, even though through the moments where he was like, he wouldn't speak to me. I said hi to him every day, and it just showed, for me, it showed me that love really like shines through. If you persevere in love, and if you keep trying to love someone, even if you don't see the reaction right away, even if someone rejects you, like deep down, maybe it will make an impact on that person, and it can only do good. You know, love can only do good. And I saw that in him, you know, even though maybe he didn't want to show it, he did love me. And like,
that sounds like a true mother's experience there. But that's great, great. Well, thank you so much for sharing your faith and your journey with us, and keep up the good work.
Thank you, Paul.
Well, I always love talking to Cenacolo. We've had him on a number of times, and it's a community for, you know, desperate youth, people, some struggling with addiction, and they really, we work with their community some here in Birmingham, and they come in humbled, you know, they're kind of beaten to their knees. They live a very austere life.
They do.
Tell us about that a little bit.
Yeah, they do a lot. What they have over there, I mean, they live pretty much off of all the nations, and like the food they raise, they do a lot of gardening and they grow their own crops, work with the pigs and the chickens, and they're out there.
And the community here doesn't have air conditioning, doesn't have heat.
They do their own laundry like by hand.
Yeah.
So that's a rarity. Somebody's in charge of cooking for all the community out there. But they do, I know, these like long rosary marches and pray, and spend a lot of time in prayer. And, it's a very part of their life there in Cenacolo, and they hold each other accountable.
So. And when I'm there, they have a great sense of peace.
I
think that connects with the video we saw, you know, how God gives us His peace, that through His suffering, death, and resurrection, He has bestowed this peace upon us. He's prepared a place for us through redemption and salvation. He's waiting for us to come to the house of the Father. And when I go to their houses, I feel that
peace.
They're
very welcoming, too.
Yeah, they're very welcoming.
Very welcome.
They have all the time in the world for you because they're stripped of everything. You know, the other thing I wanted to comment too was, you know, the women on the show tonight had such a beauty about them, and not in like the way the world oftentimes objectifies women. They just had a radiance and a beauty of like finding themselves and in being who God called
finding
them to
themselves
be.
In God.
Yeah.
And one of the things I notice a lot of times for those who persevere is there is a transformation. You see them build these great leadership skills and talents and really see them in a different light than who they were whenever you see that. And it is beautiful. And as you, you know, during the interview, you know, you have sisters who are going out there and they're taking care of kids and they love them as if they were their own children.
Right.
And that's very powerful.
Right. And they've gotten there through surrender.
Yeah.
They've surrendered to God's will and they're seeking God's will. So that's our end of the Vineyard challenge this week, is to surrender to God. Let His plan, you know, work in you, you know, to follow His plan, to seek His will in all things. And God will lead you to do beautiful things for Him. Might be small, might be something very big, and it can be seen. Mm-hmm. But He will do something beautiful with you, and you'll find His peace through surrender. So we'll send you into that vineyard. May our Heavenly Father shine His face upon you. May He give you His peace. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. See you next week on Life on the Rock.
Gonna walk.